And welcome to those of you who are new to our campus, who have not visited us before. We're excited to have you joining us. I am going to start our event by introducing our Dean, Larizon Oskoy. Dean Oskoy is a professor of marketing and managing director of the Responsible Business Coalition here at Fordham University Gabelli School of Business. She is the 2022 recipient of the American Marketing Association's Christopher Lovelock Career Contributions to Service Discipline Award for teaching, research, and service that has had the greatest long-term impact on the development of the service discipline. This is the highest award presented in the field of the service marketing. She's also an author, a New York Times bestseller, with her book, The Wallet Allocation Rule, and she has authored numerous other books and articles. Dean Oskoy is a Fulbright scholar. She received her PhD in marketing from the Keenan Flagler Business School, University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and an MBA from George Mason University. And she got her BS in Business Administration for Hacettepe University, which is in Turkey. Thank you so much for being here, Dean Oskoy.
Thank you so much. First, I want to say welcome to everyone, to our students, to our guests, to our panelists, and of course, to Roger. I want to thank you for joining us. I'm really excited about the screening of this documentary, Farm Free or Die, by our award-winning producer, writer, editor, and director, Roger Sorkin. Roger has been a really good friend to the Gabelli School for many, many years. In fact, when I met him today, we noticed that even though we've known each other for three and a half years, maybe more, this is the first time we're meeting in person. So it was always on a Zoom screen. We've been fortunate enough that he's shared his talent with us over the years. But one of the things that that really is amazing about him is that he's a change maker. And at the Gabelli School, we share his passion to drive change for a more sustainable and prosperous world. And this film, his storytelling and the conversations and action it generates is one way that Roger is leading change. Roger makes his mission, makes mission-driven films designed to strengthen civilizational security. And prior to founding the American Resilience Project, Roger consulted with and created documentary and dramatic films for a wide range of nonprofit, academic, and dramatic and government institutions, including the US Global Leadership Campaign, USAID, NATO, Flex Your Rights Foundation, American Cancer Society, and more. And as I mentioned, he has taught energy and environmental communication at the Fordham University's Gabelli School of Business. And he has also lectured at NASA, the US Military Academy at West Point, and the US Naval Academy. Roger is a fellow with the Truman National Security Project, and he has served on the Climate and Security Working Group at the Center for Climate and Security and on the Managed Retreat Expert Group with the American Society of Adaptation Professionals. He graduated from anthropology from Johns Hopkins University and worked at as a public radio journalist and producer and also an English teacher in Spain, where I hear his daughter is studying this semester, and then received a Master's of Communication from Stanford with a focus in documentary film. So please join me in giving a very warm Gabelli School welcome to Roger Sorkin.
Thank you, Larizon, and thank you, Liz. Thank you, everybody, for coming today. I'll get right to the movie. I just want to say that when I make these films, I think about what is the film designed to accomplish. It's not just that I'm interested in telling a particular story. In this case, we have the U.S. Farm Bill coming up. You know, one thing we do at our nonprofit, the American Resilience Project, is we try to influence public policy with our work. So we try to figure out what is the policy outcome we'd like to see. We talk to a lot of experts because we're not those policy experts ourselves. In this case, we talk to a lot of folks in the agriculture space, agribusiness, to really give us that guidance. What should be in the Farm Bill? What are the problems that we need to solve? And once those are clear, we go back and we make the film to try to support that effort. So the Farm Bill, for those of you who don't know, is a huge piece of federal legislation. It comes up every 5 years. It's hundreds of billions of dollars of our tax dollars that are allocated for all kinds of things. We'll learn a little bit more about that during our panel discussion. But what we see is a real need to make regenerative agriculture the foundation of this upcoming Farm Bill. We know that this is a really great chance to help fight the climate crisis, and that regenerative agriculture is really one of the best tools that we have right now at our disposal to take carbon out of the atmosphere and at the same time help farmers make a living and stay on their land in the face of a lot of climate disasters that they're experiencing that previous generations of farmers did not experience. I guess without further ado, I will just ask you, as you think about this, you know, knowing most of you are business students, it's actually really encouraging to see that you're thinking about your futures in the context of other sectors, you know, thinking of environmental protection and conservation and sustainability. You know, all of you probably know the term ESG. It's probably worked its way into your curricula by this point. But think about, as you're watching, what can you do as future business leaders to move into this agricultural space, or at least from the maybe supply chains that you might be working on, think about how they're related to the agriculture space. Because as we know, there's a lot of intersection points with lots of business sectors. And so that said, we'll come back for a panel discussion in a little while. I hope you enjoy the film and we can start it. Thank you.
Have a limited amount of time every year to actually produce a crop. Everything has to happen like clockwork. A lot of Americans don't realize just how tenuous our food supply is.
We've got enough stress. We're worried about bugs, we're worried about the markets, we're worried about whether or not China's buying corn. But we can see the weather. Climate change is absolutely real for farmers because we're living it.
If we can improve our soils to where our soils are now a buffer for the extreme weather changes that we're seeing, we're going to see more stable yields.
The future of the country is at stake. And we need to get the message out to people. We have a lot of allies and a lot of friends in towns and in the cities. They just need to know we're out here and we need help. The fact that agriculture just doesn't make an adequate income to support families is what it's all about. There are all kinds of people that want to go back to the farm and ranch. They loved their life on that farm or that ranch. It's all they want to do. But the income isn't there.
If you look at farming today and you look at like corn prices, are you kidding me? Am I going to do that? I have to work 7 days a week for that? You can work a lot less and make more money and have more time off in a different occupation than farming. You can't work 7 days a week for your whole life. You just can't do it.
Raise products below the cost of production and stay in business. The older farmers like me are going to decide to quit. The younger farmers that are coming along, there's nobody going to finance them, because you don't finance a fellow when he's going to show you a loss rather than a profit.
Right now we grow commodities. I grow corn that goes to chickens that gets eaten by people. So you don't really think of it as food. It's very difficult to. I mean, we're trained not to because that's how we make our living. And I think that people need to realize that this is their food and they should demand to know how it's grown.
Ever since we did that and got back with our original lawyer, he said he would go forward with it, but I can't even get him to respond to an email to find out what the status of that application is.
I see. I'm so sorry to hear about that.
There's only two ways to become a farmer. You're either born into it or you marry into it. Otherwise, there's really no other way for a person just to say one day, I want to farm, because the startup costs are just astronomical.
This tractor, brand new, is $180,000. Now, that was 2013. You got an alternator that runs it, just like a car. You've got all these hydraulics that run it. The hydraulic pump, if it goes out, is $10,000. You blow a tire, you're looking at $1,600. Front ones are $800. We just put new ones on there last year. The planter, this thing right here, to set it up alone, the technology is $60,000. The planter itself was $130,000. And then you add the monitor, the GPS, and you're up to $200,000 automatically. So all together, this is $380,000. This is a 5-bedroom house with a swimming pool in the back.
All our modern machinery is pretty much operated by electronics and software, and we're prevented by the manufacturers of actually accessing certain parts of that machine. You know, we don't have the tools to diagnose our equipment anymore. The dealership won't even sell it to us. So here we are, you know, I've got a wheat crop, I've got a harvest. I've got a wheat crop that's deteriorating in the field as we speak. I've got weather systems coming in that could potentially ruin my wheat crop. I can't be waiting for the dealership to send a technician out with a laptop to hook up to the combine. You know, farmers are known to be very resourceful, to take whatever resources they have at hand and make things work. I should have the ability to get the same resources as a dealership does to diagnose my machine, to repair my machine.
When there's not farm businesses that are healthy around the area, they don't buy as much stuff in town. So those businesses shutter up their windows. And if you have less and less young people coming back that have a chance to get into, in our areas, into food production. So what happens if young people have no direct route, no way to be able to purchase land and get on the land with a path to ownership?
To buy a farm, to buy a good ranch that can support yourself on, I'm going to say you probably have to have around 5,000 acres where I live. That's going to be $3 million minimum. Most people have no way to come up with that cash. So the land is sold to a bigger entity, whether that be corporations from out of state or out of the country.
There's a lot of discussion today about ownership of farmland. There are international parties that are trying to buy it. We see large companies that are coming in trying to buy it. Well, there was a time when Made American truly meant that. But nowadays, we need to, I think, be very careful as to who we allow in as owners of our food-producing assets.
Rent land. I'm a tenant farmer, and I've been farming about 8 years now. I'm not inheriting farm or land, but like, I don't need 500 acres. I don't need 200 acres. Like, if I had 200 acres, I'd love to collaboratively farm that with others and like do livestock and do different type of enterprises all together. So I'm really looking for maybe 5 acres, but I still can't afford to buy 5 acres right now. And when you get out into these rural communities, a lot of the dwellings and the places to live, they're gone. So to find 5, 10 acres or something like that with a house that you could live in with your family is really hard.
Click over here, then it'll be better.
We need to get serious about figuring out how to grow food on smaller acreages, because if you can grow food efficiently and effectively on smaller acreages, then you can transition either through leasing or purchasing smaller amounts at a time. The ownership structure of agriculture and food production needs to change. We need to have more ownership by workers and by people who are doing the physical labor.
When we raise corn, soybeans, we're fairly dependent upon the Board of Trade to dictate the price. And we can make more money sequestering carbon in the carbon markets. That's something that's unique to plants with photosynthesis that are actually taking CO2 out of the air. Well, this leads to a whole new business opportunity. We can capitalize on this so that our next cash crop is carbon farming. A very unique way that we can add value and keep farmers on the farm.
To me, carbon should be my new cash crop. It should be a commodity. No doubt, the biggest carbon footprint most people have is their food. But if you don't know the carbon footprint of your food, how do you know you're buying responsibility? Do you know where the organic produce came from? Organic chicken, where did the feed come from? Did it come from Argentina? Did it come from Australia? To feed a chicken that then got processed? Is it better for the planet? But there's no way to know. I'm a farmer and don't know.
As a row crop farmer, we grow cash crops about 4 months out of the year. That leaves a full 8 months of opportunity that we could have something growing on our land, even if we're not growing it as a cash crop that we're going to actually harvest. It's plants that can be sequestering carbon from the atmosphere and putting it back into the soil.
Regenerative agriculture lowers our cost of production, and it also increases the soil organic matter. And with cover crops, it increases our soil's ability to absorb moisture. So when we do get these heavy rains and stuff, it doesn't all wash off. We're protecting our soil from wind erosion, water erosion. We've been more profitable than we would be without regenerative agriculture. And along with that, we can be monetizing it now through the carbon markets.
My grandfather farmed this land in the 20s and 30s. One of the things that he inculcated into me was, hey, you know, you're a steward of the land. You need to make sure that it's better than it was when you inherited it, when you pass it down to your children. We started in about 2014 in precision agriculture by taking the technology that we were familiar with in the military service and using it in sustainable or regenerative agriculture. What we need to be able to do is manage our crops, our fields, down to as small an area as we can. And in order to do that, you have to have the capability of developing what we call situational awareness. And you have these platforms where you bring this data in, you fuse it, and you analyze it, and you're able to act on it.
Most farmers, we look where they can make money. And the healthier the soil is, the better chance you'll have to make a higher yield. And with those improvements in technology, we've been able to eliminate trips over the field, save fuel, and make our farming operations more profitable with less inputs. And by using cover crops, we can save our topsoil, we can increase the profitability of the farmland, we can reduce the amount of soil as well as fertilizer, herbicides, and pesticides going into rivers and streams and being wasted.
One of the projects that we've been pursuing is measuring the amount of carbon in soil. And that's important because what that does is it gives a boost to the carbon market because you have a better understanding of actually what's there from year to year if you can measure it rather than just doing a lot of modeling and estimating.
So farmers are the reason that we can have negative carbon feedstocks going into our plant. Connecting carbon markets through our fuels and our final users of those fuels, we are doing everything we can to incentivize those best practices in ag, so regenerative agriculture, to the final fuel. And connecting those systems is how you really build that value versus just a carbon market on its own. And by having a fuel that we can have a higher value on because it's a low carbon fuel or a zero carbon fuel is how we are connecting those systems to be as efficient as possible.
I think a market for carbon is one of the only ways to get farmers into regenerative agriculture at a wide scale. And at the end of the day, if I'm gonna go broke, putting carbon back into the soil, I'm probably not gonna do it. If I'm gonna see some kind of incentive, whether it's through the value-added aspect of a product or through a direct payment, I'm probably more likely to do it.
If they can't make a profit, I don't care what you show them, they're not interested. And it's been said since I started farming, and we still say it, we'd rather have the market than to have the subsidy. If we got the right market, we don't need no subsidy. If we don't have the right market, somebody's got to subsidize or there won't be a farm.
The state of Maryland pays me to cover crop, and that's what got me to start cover cropping. No-till and cover crop are what sequester carbon into the ground. So that subsidy, because I didn't believe in cover crops, I thought it was just the environmentalists telling me what to do. But since they were paying me, I was willing to listen. And that's what transformed our farm into farming the way we do. But it was through that initial subsidy that made it work. But as we start to figure out how to get that carbon footprint of the food to the consumer, we need a stepping stone. We need something in between, and I think that's the carbon markets. I think the carbon markets come in and vet what everyone does. You've got people on the ground checking the soil to make sure that the carbon's there. So then I have a product that's marketable. It has a numerical value of how much carbon was sequestered in the soil and the growing of that product. And I'm not a huge believer in the government taking over markets. But I think where we need the government and where we need policy is in the vetting of the markets. How do we know as a farmer, now that there's 10 or 15 different markets to sell carbon on, how do we know which ones are good and which ones are not?
The order declares meat plants as critical infrastructure. At least 20 meatpacking workers have died from COVID-19, more than 5,000.
We've seen during COVID-19 what one break in the chain in our food supply can cause of actually getting the product to the grocery stores. And that was only just a brief disruption of our food supply. What if we have an even worse drought than what we had in 2007? That disrupts food supply over the entire country. The key to a secure food supply is spreading production over a large number of producers over a wide area. We need everybody producing in each state in the country so we can mitigate any potential disasters we will have in a given year.
Through all the things that happened with COVID and the pandemic, our tribe is really taking it serious now about developing food security in our communities. We have about 1,000 acres of organic crops growing, from corn to wheat to alfalfa, oats. And we even have organic field peas this year. A lot of this stuff was driven by the lack of access to fresh, nutritious foods in Winnebago. And we've gone away from things like this, growing our own food. Now we're getting all this food production into our schools, into our hospitals, into our local food stores, and just getting people to start eating better. On top of that, increasing the physical health, the mental health. I think it's extremely important that a lot of rural communities start to plan longer term for the food security within their communities. Not only is it going to help give you that reassurance of food, but I think it brings back a sense of community. It brings back a sense of connection to the land that you're around.
We're getting beat down by weather that old-time farmers have never seen stuff like this before. It just seems like it's getting more and more unpredictable, more extreme. And it's like, holy cow, if you don't believe in climate change, it's insane. It's so obvious.
Well, I've been farming since 1973, and I've never seen weather patterns like we've had the last few years. Either we have way too much rain or no rain. We have mild winters where it hardly ever freezes. We have the coldest weather on Earth. We have a 100-year flood here every 5 years. This isn't normal, and what we're seeing is the extremes are now the norm. Farming is maybe not quite as labor intense as it was, but it's a lot more mentally stressful than it has been. And we're seeing this all across rural America. We're seeing farmers struggling with depression and everything else.
This year we've had a big soybean crop, and it's typically shipped down to New Orleans. And then right before harvest, Hurricane Ida comes in and damages a lot of those grain facilities down there. And all of a sudden, our price that we're set to receive for our crops drops like a rock. When you throw in those kinds of stresses where you do everything you can all year long, everything's perfect. And then at the last moment, a severe storm comes in that doesn't even affect your area, but affects another part of the country. It's enough to make you wonder, why are we doing this? What's the point of banging our heads against the wall? Is there no end in sight to some of the added stresses that we're having to face due to these extreme weather events?
My brother and I, we both vowed to keep the farm and the family no matter what, and farm first, even if we had other businesses, like we made that pact. My brother's a true believer in that as I am, and knowing all that blood, sweat, and tears that our ancestors put in to give us a chance to be on this land.
For sure.
I feel pretty lucky about that, and that's worth fighting for.
I mean, that's what brought me back. Like, I was an IT major. I moved to D.C. for 10 years, you know? Like, I had a career out there. I came back to the farm for family. So we have an obligation to make the farm successful because Dad sacrificed everything to make it work.
Yeah.
And we're fifth generation. I mean, you know, it's not just Dad. It was, you know, it was generations before him. So better not screw it up.
I've got mixed emotions about the potential of my kids coming back to the family farm. I mean, on one hand, obviously, I'd be proud. You know, this farm has been in our family at this location since 1882, and I'm the fifth generation to run it. That's a fact I'm extremely proud of. And if one of my kids could be the sixth generation, I mean, I don't think anything could make me prouder. And if it's what they feel called to do, then I'm in 100% support. But on the other hand, I've got smart kids. I've got kids who I feel can do anything they put their mind to. And I really don't want to see them come back to this way of life and struggle.
How do you bring more people back to agriculture and have a sound connection with the land and with the animals on the land and the food that is produced on the land? How do you incentivize it? And policy is a big piece of the puzzle. We need to rework the Farm Bill in a big, big way.
The problem with federal farm policy is that our needs here in the Southeast are different than farmers' needs in the Midwest or out West. But they've got a one-size-fits-all policy that really doesn't come close to filling anybody's needs. It's better than no support at all, but there's so much that can be improved on.
We need to rebuild rural America. We need to redo it from the bottom up. And we want to be at the table with legislators and policymakers. And so when it comes to the Farm Bill, we need to be the mouse that roared, and we need to get in there and say how we want to help better our communities and better our nation.
Farmers and ranchers, people who produce food, are affected very drastically by public policy. But in the past, farmers and ranchers haven't been so willing to talk to folks from the city or eager to talk to folks in organized labor or in meatpacking plants. We need to set aside what we might perceive are differences because we're all trying to make a living in the same economic system. And we've got to be able to see how those things connect to each other. Everyone eats food. Everyone has some small part in the agriculture system.
The climate is changing. Farmers need to be put in a lead role to help mitigate the situation. And we need good policy that can help protect us in these changing times, as well as protect all the consumers that depend on us to raise a good food product for them. And so this is a call to action to help transition the farmer to regenerative agriculture, because regenerative agriculture is the best weapon we have to fight the climate crisis.
Just believe them. You don't have
show me the way around it. Well, the way is filled with pitfalls, and sometimes we may fall. But you can't have His grace, my friend, on your knees down at the altar. You don't have to move that mountain, just help me, Lord, to climb it. You don't have to move that stumbling block, just show me.
We're going to have a panel discussion, and this is actually going to be recorded for my organization's podcast. We're the American Resilience Project. So this is the American Resilience Podcast. So if you have questions and you want to ask them, you can be on the podcast. So enticing, isn't that? Let me just say a few more words. I'm going to actually formally start the podcast now. So we're going live. It's a tape. So welcome, everybody. Thank you, Fordham University Gabelli School of Business, for screening Farm Free or Die, and for giving us this opportunity to record the latest episode of the American Resilience Podcast from American Resilience Project in front of a live audience of Gabelli students and others who in the community have come today. My name is Roger Sorkin. I'm the director of the American Resilience Project. We make films that are designed to influence public policy, inspire cultural change, and strengthen civilizational security. Joining us today, it is my pleasure to introduce a panel of experts to talk about the Farm Bill, among other things. Just getting to bios, thank you. So our first guest, Suzanne Hunt. Thank you for joining us, Suzanne. Suzanne is a co-owner of Hunt Country Vineyards, our family's seventh generation farm, and 41-year-old winery in the Finger Lakes region of New York. She's also vice president of policy for Generate Upcycle, PBC, which finances, builds, owns, and operates sustainable infrastructure projects. She serves in many advisory roles, including the Agriculture and Forestry Advisory Panel to the New York Climate Action Council, and for Cornell Agritech. And at Suzanne's family winery, she has spearheaded a multitude of sustainability and climate mitigation, adaptation, and resilience efforts. Our other guest is Nicole Carta, who is an adjunct professor here at Fordham. Nicole worked for 10 years at the United Nations, International Agricultural Development. Do I have that right?
International Fund for Agricultural Development.
International Fund for Agricultural Development in Rome, which is focused on agricultural supply chain sustainability, working with corporations on improving livelihoods for smallholder farmers in developing countries on everything from climate resiliency to incomes to crop productivity. So thank you both for joining us. We'll just start off with you, Suzanne. Would like to hear your perspective as a farmer and someone who works in this space beyond just someone who has a family farm, to talk about how regenerative agriculture is a really key method for improving soil health, and how improving soil health is maybe one of the best things we can do to fight the climate crisis.
It's a big, broad question to get started on. Well, first of all, thank you all for coming and being interested in this topic, and thank you for that film. It is just so good, and it hits so many of the key topics. And I think, you know, we're at this moment when we're realizing that this kind of conventional, what's become the conventional way of farming, and that the Farm Bill has shaped over the last decades, isn't sustainable and it has to shift to a more regenerative model if we're going to have resiliency back in our farm system, because these farm bill programs have resulted in a landscape that is an agricultural landscape that's quite fragile and is susceptible to physical disruption, market disruptions, labor disruptions, all of it. So to transition and to develop our policies so that farmers are able to transition to these practices that put more carbon in the soil makes their farms more resilient, which makes our food system more resilient, and also helps us to mitigate the climate problem. So I think it's a win-win-win. But I don't know if I answered your question.
No, I think the idea of soil health. I mean, I think there have been provisions on soil health specifically that are maybe part of this upcoming farm bill, but have also been just separate pieces of legislation that folks that I've talked to in the regenerative agriculture space say, if you're going to focus on one thing, let's start with soil health. I don't know if you would agree with that, but are there other things that are missing from that priority list?
Yeah, so I mean, soil health is foundational, and so I'm thrilled that people are really focusing on that. I think what we've seen is most people focusing, as many of the farmers in the film did, on carbon, because that is where the most activity is. It's where the willingness to pay is in many of these ecosystem services. But I think we also need to focus more broadly on the health of the farm system and soil health more broadly than just soil carbon, so that we don't have an imbalance in the system. So for example, you can focus on, if only focusing on carbon in the soil is a little bit like only focusing on the wheat in your loaf of bread. You can't really make a loaf of bread with just wheat. You need all the other ingredients. You can't have soil health if you only focus on practices that focus on carbon. You have to focus on all the other aspects of a healthy soil ecosystem. So yeah, soil health is a better focus than just the carbon piece, for sure.
Nicole Carta, you worked for 10 years in the United Nations. You have a very international focus on this. I should say this is, we're recording this on the 1-year anniversary of Russia's brutal invasion of Ukraine. And for those of you who've been following that unfolding story, you might have heard something about Ukraine as a grain producer. Ukraine is a very large grain producer. And so we see these ripple effects from the war in Ukraine spreading out from there. I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about international food security with regards to the Farm Bill and food aid, and if you can maybe just say something about how these ripple effects about from things that we don't think maybe affect us on the other side of the world are actually impacting our own supply chains, our farmers' livelihoods, and our food security at home.
Sure. Yeah, no, great point, and you're right. Deserves recognition today of this, massive tragedy that has impacted all kinds of different ways of our life, but certainly with our food. So I think we know that our food system is very highly interrelated. And I want to pick up on something that Suzanne mentioned specifically about how this U.S. Farm Bill, through its interconnected networks of subsidies, has created a food system in the United States that's largely highly subsidized on 4 or 5 different crops. And it's corn, wheat, rice, cotton, soybeans. And unfortunately, most of the subsidies that are being paid to farmers are not the farmers that we've met in this beautiful documentary. Thank you very much, Roger, for making this important piece, but larger corporate farms. What a lot of people don't know is also included in the U.S. Farm Bill is all of the U.S. food aid, international food aid. It's a very small part of what is largely an $800 billion bill. I think that's the projected 5-year spend of the U.S. Farm Bill. It's about $700 to $800 billion. The largest part of that is actually for food nutrition assistance for Americans who can no longer afford the system that we've created through subsidies. But a small piece impacts international farmers as well, in 2 different main ways. One is, as you all know, because you're business students, that when you subsidize a production, it usually leads to a cheaper output or a cheaper production method for that particular group that's receiving that subsidy. So that subsidy, those subsidized farmers have a higher competition to smaller farmers in developing countries that are not receiving a subsidy. So essentially, it's giving the United States some unfair competitive advantage over smaller countries. The second way is what we've mentioned earlier, and that's linked to our international food aid. And the United States delivers that in two different ways. One is in-kind, and the other is market-based. In-kind, as you might, as it sounds, is the U.S. government buys from our farmers, ships it abroad to a challenged food insecure region, and dumps or places the free food into that market. You can imagine if there is any kind of a viable agricultural system, how that farmer can compete with free, they cannot. So not only, yes, you might solve an acute crisis situation, but you're basically contributing to a longer-term decimation of that agricultural system and going to contribute to sort of a cyclical or a self-fulfilling prophecy of continued need for food aid. Second, and here's a bright spot, and I'm gonna hand it back over, is we also do market-based programs. So increasingly, the United States government is buying locally or regionally where they can, either through vouchers that they give communities to be able to buy the food if they can't afford it, or for the government to procure it. And that has actually increased in the last 10 years. Our market used to just be 10% of food aid. It's now up at 60%. And the in-kind went from 70% to about 30%. So a bit of a bright spot there.
Suzanne, I'm glad you brought that up about ecosystem services. I'd like to talk a little bit more about that. There was a lot of talk about carbon being a new cash crop. I think in theory that sounds great. In practice, that's a bit of a challenge to get there. Can you talk a little bit more about what ecosystem services are or what they can be and how we might work incentives into the Farm Bill to allow more farmers to do that? And I should say, you know, we've got a room full of business students. What kind of business opportunities might there be for people who don't necessarily think they're going to go off and be farmers, but may want to work in the agricultural business space?
Sure. Yeah. Well, let me just start with the carbon markets, because they are developing and it's a big focus in the film. And what I would say is I would echo what one of the farmers said, which is, you know, not my first reaction isn't to say the government should get involved and run a market. However, because we're in the Wild West phase with these carbon markets right now, especially for soil carbon, you really need a sheriff to come in and lay down the rules of the road and enforce them. So we really do need the government to play a role in policing these carbon markets so that the farmers actually get the benefit and get the lion's share of the money, because many of the companies that are getting started in the space right now are setting themselves up as the middlemen. And it's just history repeating itself, where the farmers get like the peanuts and the middlemen take the lion's share of the resources. So I think that that's a critical outcome that hopefully your advocacy in this film can drive towards, is the Farm Bill setting some rules to the road for carbon markets related to agriculture. A healthy farm agroecosystem provides all kinds of ecosystem services. So sequestering or storing and storing carbon is one of them. Biodiversity preservation is another one of them. My family has a small farm in the Finger Lakes in New York, and we have all kinds of wildlife. Many of the farms across this part of the country have some forest on them, so it's not just fields. Our farm is about a third vineyards, about a third forests, and about a third hay fields and other fields. And so there's biodiversity. There's also benefits to storm mitigation. So we've been focusing on adding soil carbon to our farm for a long time. My parents and my brother have been doing a lot with compost and mulch and all kinds of things. And so when we get these incredible downpours that we've been getting, we don't have a lot of runoff. Our parking lot is the only part of the farm that has a lot of runoff, because our soil is so rich in organic matter, it acts like a sponge. So the more we have farms farming regeneratively, rebuilding the soil carbon, you have much less flood damage. So you've got flood mitigation, there's a whole array of ecosystem services that healthy farms provide. And so the Farm Bill, instead of subsidizing commodity crop production, which drives farmers to make decisions about crops to plant that are based on a government policy instead of what's good for their farm and what's good for people. And that is one of the fundamental changes that we need. So not only do we need to reorient these policies to provide payments for ecosystem services, we need to reorient them so that farmers can choose a much more complex mix of crops that are much better for their soil
and reduce the amount of chemical and external inputs that are needed.
So sometimes I feel like making these films is the easy part. The hard part is getting people to actually do something after they watch the film. And that's where, you know, we all can play some sort of role. And Nicole, I'd like to ask, what advice, what guidance might you give anyone who's listening to this on how they can help be part of the solution? What can you do no matter where you sit, whether you're a business student or somebody else who's listening to this? Sure. How can they make sure that we have the kind of food system in place that is reflected in the upcoming Farm Bill?
Yeah, that's a great question, an important one. And I'll leave it, I think, to Suzanne to talk a little bit about the policy actions you might take. But I think on a local level, just educate yourself about the food that you're eating. I mean, we could have a whole another film and another hour discussion about food waste, but we know that it's a massive issue. It's a huge contributor, as we heard, to climate. But, you know, become aware of the products that you're buying. You know, think about things like food miles, right? Which is you're buying fruits and vegetables in the grocery store a block from here. But is it strawberry season? Probably not, you know? So try and make some personal changes you can in your life to eat seasonally. Go upstate, meet some farmers, talk to some farmers.
Drink some wine.
Find out how challenging it can be. I mean, if any of you have tried to grow a houseplant, I don't know about you all, but it's very difficult. Imagine trying to produce for consumption. Use your local green market, compost. You know, make it an effort and a priority in your life.
Anything you want to answer that?
Yeah, I would say.
Specifically on the policy side, what can you say? You know, when we talk about, I think it's easy to be cynical about the political process and the policymaking process. And, you know, we see all this money in politics and just the average citizen doesn't necessarily feel that they have a way to be influential. We were talking earlier about the fact that people in Congress, they still take note of how often their phone rings. Can you talk a little bit about your experience in the advocacy space?
Absolutely. Now, how many folks are American citizens? So most of the room. Presumably the rest of you are citizens of another country. So it's still relevant for everyone. But in this country, it's amazing how few people actually call their representatives in government and share their thoughts. And you know, money in government is an absolutely critical issue and it needs to be dealt with. And it's a huge problem. But all of these government representatives that elected officials have to get reelected. They need the votes. And so when constituents call or write their offices, they really take note. So I would say everyone, if you do anything in 2023, like figure out who your representative is locally. There's the local assembly and Senate, and then there's also, but especially for the Farm Bill, your national representatives. Figure out who your congressperson is and who your senators are, and take 5 minutes to call each of their offices and tell them that this is important or whatever you think is important. And once you've done it once, it is so easy. It takes 5 minutes, if that. And you can have some really interesting conversations with the staff people that pick up the phone. Sometimes they'll just say, tell me your zip code, where do you live? And it'll be quick. And then sometimes you get into really interesting, thoughtful conversations. And if you're ever in Washington, make an appointment to stop in and meet the staff people in your representative's office. Is incredibly impactful. You'd be surprised because so everyone's cynical and no one does it. So when you do, it's quite powerful, actually.
Great. All right, let's open it up to questions. We've got a microphone coming around, so feel free to say your name and what you're studying and tell us a little bit about yourself, or you can just ask your question.
The name is Sorkin, and there is a relationship. But the question I have, I'm an attorney in Midtown Manhattan, so I don't deal much with farmers. Do farmers have the ability, Midwest, South, Far West, which is having a major water shortage and so forth, the ability to, I don't want to say unionize, but as a group, simply say, we're not growing wheat this year. We can't afford to grow it. We can't afford to grow soybeans. Get together as a group And I don't see that. I mean, pilots go on strike. They don't like their hours. Unions are pushing for whatever they're pushing for. But I don't see that coming from the agricultural people, the people who actually grow and deal with the issues raised by this documentary. What do we do about that? How do we get them on board?
Well, Roger's dad, nice to meet you. I mean, gosh, there's so many ways to answer that. So first, I would say there are a number of farmers that are very engaged. I actually met David Coulthard, who was featured in D.C. when we were both there railing against bad positions that the Farm Bureau was taking. And that's how we met. He heard me railing against their positions on climate change, you know, 15 years ago, and we've been friends ever since. So many farmers do get engaged and do advocacy. What I will say is that you saw with these folks, like when you're working 7 days a week, and then most farms have a side hustle, they have off-farm income, or they're making value-added products. My parents started making wine in the early 80s because the grape market had crashed, and they had just taken on a whole bunch of debt to plant a bunch of vineyards, which were now the collateral on the debt, so they couldn't even rip them out and plant something else. So most farmers are working 7 days a week year round. And so it's really hard to then go out and pay for flights to get to DC to do advocacy. So most of them depend on their industry associations to be their voice in these forums. And what's happened there is you have, we need a bottle of wine to talk about this, but you get these very narrow interests. So you've got the corn growers, and you have the soy growers association, and you have the Farm Bureau, which has a whole insurance arm, and they represent this whole insurance thing and not really farmers anymore. And so you get this whole kind of warping of the messages that are coming through that are supposed to represent farmers. So then folks set up new associations because they want to be represented, and you just have this fracturing of the farmer voice.
Yeah, and I'll just add, internationally, there are a lot of smallholder pharma groups in particular. In fact, 80% of the world's poor are farmers. But I think it comes down to power dynamics. You know, I mean, at the end of the day, especially when you have a hugely subsidized agricultural industry in the form of the United States, I mean, they said there's
a segment of the agricultural industry, distinct segment.
Right. And the processors, right? We're talking about the Cargills of the world, the Archer Daniels Midlands and others. They just, you know, their voice can only go so far. We were also talking earlier that a lot of multinational companies, consumer good brands, you know, that produce things like fortified vegetable cubes, right? Like a bouillon cube. We all know the brands behind that. But that's actually, we don't even think about, like, that's actually a vegetable in those bouillon cubes, right? And it's sourced primarily from international markets. Those companies are deeply concerned about the environmental footprint and actually their supply, right? Because they know, this kind of goes back to our food bill, if we are not supporting or we're decimating local agricultural markets by dumping extra commodities, we're not building a sustainable supply chain, right? Because it's not just the farmer, it's the growers, it's the watersheds, it's the processors, it's the rural paved roads that a farmer needs to get their product to market. If we're not supporting that, those companies are very worried that their supply chains are going to dry up, right? Whether it's chocolate or vegetables. But at the end of the day, there's just so much lift that needs to go in that, and investment, frankly. And there is some good investment going into it, mostly through multilateral development banks, large scale, but not enough yet, I'd say.
I'll say one thing. You know, some of the interviews that I did for the film, you know, you didn't see it in the finished version, but that conversation came up, and geography is just a big part of it. Also, you think about farmers, they're spread out, and you know, back in the, you know, if you're talking about the United Auto Workers, you got hundreds of people working in a plant. It's easy to get together after work, talk about what are your concerns, come to the meeting on Tuesday night. It's really hard for farmers to all be in a, you know, not just the question of the fact that they're working on the farm all the time. But just, they don't really see each other all that much. So it's hard to organize as a group.
Yeah. Yep.
So my question is around food wastage. So it seems like we put a lot of pressure on our farmers to have to deliver, but then there seems to be a ton of food wastage. And, you know, that could be just us as, you know, the general public consumers. We're not very well versed in how we can better maybe recycle or compost. But I just wonder if that can be part of the solution. Is there a way that we can maybe build that in so that we're, you know, our food wastage can be part of policy or part of the solution where we're helping farmers, that also there's not such a huge demand on them to have to produce if, as a society, we're not using or consuming our food in the best method we can be?
Oh, I could go on about this one for hours as well. No, so the food waste question, it's such a good question. So, I mean, one dynamic of subsidizing commodities is that you then have cheap food, which is then easy to waste because it's cheap and we don't value it. And we're not, we don't really take on board how valuable it is. And I haven't looked at the numbers recently, but last I knew, the U.S. is a portion of our total income. We spend less on our food than most every other wealthy nation. So there's that dynamic. We absolutely have to waste less food. In New York, we passed a law in 2019 that requires large producers of food waste to divert it to beneficial use. So with my other hat, with Generate Upcycle, we're, I think, the largest food waste recycler in the country right now. We have composters, we have anaerobic digesters for things like expired soda and beer that can't go to composting, but it can be digested and depackaged with sophisticated machines. And then the aluminum goes to recycling and all that beverage gets digested. So there's a number of technologies and companies that are working on that. But there's got to be a lot of education to reduce food waste, make sure that food is going to food kitchens. If it's getting near end of life, we need to reform how we label things. Often things are past their best use, but they're still perfectly fine. So there's a whole world of folks there. NRDC has folks that have been working on this if you want to get involved in the policy side. But yeah, it's a big issue. For sure. But then, you know, there's always going to be food scraps unless we start eating our bananas and our avocado pits and shells and things. Mm-hmm. So to the extent that there's always going to be some food scraps, we need to build out the infrastructure to compost and digest all of that material and use it as natural fertilizer instead of the synthetic fertilizers that are helping to deplete our soil carbon instead of build it.
Yeah, maybe I would just add, Khalid, Breathe, what you're saying about we have subsidized a food system that's not profitable, basically. If you took the subsidies away right now, it costs more, I think, to produce than what market rates would be offering. So people are not incentivized to be more mindful. In fact, just this morning while leaving the house, my husband and I were discussing this. And the concern is, though, if suddenly you just pulled out all the subsidies and food costs what it really costs to produce, the poor people would be hit really hard immediately. There, unfortunately, we have huge issues in income gaps in this country. But you could subsidize their purchase of the food, right? So maybe we're subsidizing the wrong thing. So we've subsidized this five crops to the point that we've created a food system that's not sustainable, and yet everyone's getting sick over it, right? Because those same crops are usually the ones that are highly processed into processed foods. We've seen diabetes rates go through the roof and so on. The last thing I'll say on that is there's something called true cost accounting, which advocates that if you really looked at the true cost of production, and not just related to food, but anything, mostly the environmental impacts of what it would really cost to produce things. And if you applied that to food, I mean, farmers would be treated like the royalty that, frankly, I think they are, because they're the stewards of the land, you know? And if you look at the impacts of climate change, we need them now more than ever, and we're not rewarding them in the way that they should be. Potentially through subsidies, but through other credits and incentives to take care of the land.
Picking up on that for a second, how might this tie in with some of the ESG reporting requirements that companies have to make now? I'm thinking specifically about emissions as they tie into the agribusiness sector, another form of waste. Is there anything you can say about in terms of ESG?
Yeah, I would imagine probably some of you in this room are finance majors, and you've been following the increasing finance, you know, reporting requirements and stipulations around ESG in scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3 emissions. So any bank that has any kind of agribusiness in their portfolio, which I'm sure that they do, now needs to start really trying to quantify the scope 3 emissions of those. So I think it's a promising direction, because it's going to force, hopefully force some of the ideas that were put forth here around, you know, really paying farmers to guard the carbon that's in their land. And banks, because we all know finance speaks and moves money. I mean, moves minds. But if banks can start to actually take credit for positive or, you know, neutral or net gains in scope 3 emissions because of the ag biz of the farms on their books, I think that's a great thing. But curious to hear if any of you in the room are you studying any of this? Are you thinking about any of this in your classes? Sorry, it's the professor coming on.
Yes, we're putting you on the spot.
I won't call anyone.
Well, and Roger asked about job opportunities. There's so much work that has to be done in terms of harmonizing reporting requirements. You know, the concerns about greenwashing are really threatening the effectiveness of all this development, and the actual greenwashing is threatening the effectiveness of all of these initiatives. So having some better and enforceable and transparent reporting requirements that make it a more effective space would be something great for you guys to help with. So one thing we haven't talked about, I think so much of the focus when we're looking at farming and the future of farming is on farmland preservation. And what I love about your film is it really brings out so many of the emotional, financial, physical challenges that farmers face. And so I've been talking with folks about farmer preservation. Mm-hmm. And so one of the reasons that I think this farm bill is sort of a do or die moment is because we're losing our farmland, but we're also losing our farmers. Mm-hmm. And they have skill sets and knowledge and experience and this culture of deep observation of their farm and what's happening and what to adjust and what to change, and knowledge of their land and their soils and what happens in this environment or that situation. That's not something that you can just restart or find in the future. I mean, we're losing skills and traditions and that, you know, that if once they're lost, they're lost. So I think we need to think, and especially in the Farm Bill, needs to reorient itself around how do we make it sustainable for farmers to farm into the future. And having reliable revenue streams is something that would reduce the stress enormously. It would allow the next generation, it would help allow the next generation to consider and plan to come back to the farms without having to risk well-being and financial ruin, basically, because of, you know, in addition to, you know, farming always having been incredibly hard, now the whole world is interconnected. So as they were saying, you know, you have to worry about what's happening in markets all over the world. So you have, you know, volatility in markets, volatility in labor markets, volatility in weather. So, folks crafting this farm bill should be thinking about what do we need to do to make it viable for farmers to keep farming. And that's why I love the ecosystem services payment structure, because we're not just subsidizing overproduction of commodities that get dumped in other places and ruin markets for other farmers. We're actually subsidizing the things we need, the resilience, practices that build resilience so that we can keep our farmers farming and keep producing food through all this crazy weather we're experiencing.
Is there anything that has been talked about with regards to the Farm Bill in terms of training, careers for people who want to go into agriculture? I mean, it seems like there's so much possibility. I mean, you don't necessarily just have to be out in the field. I mean, there's so many additional things that people can do in the agriculture space. What can you say about job training programs or working this into curricula in high schools or vocational schools?
This is definitely your area of expertise. I would just add that just a small point is that the Farm Bill is the only piece of U.S. legislation that actually includes rural development funding. So now in this year, the advocates are gathering and they're talking about, you know, broadband to rural areas. They're talking about recreation, they're talking about job training. So that's an important piece. It's not a mandated funded piece, which means that this has to be appropriated each year. For those of you that know how U.S. bills work, most of it it might be passed in Congress, but it has to be appropriated annually. Not all of it. The mandatory pieces will get funded, but the rural development pieces won't. So there's a huge role to play for organizations that are advocating exactly as you said, for training and, you know, livelihood development. I think our rural communities are often overlooked. You can certainly add more to that, Suzanne, you mentioned earlier.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard folks talk about Climate Corps as part of the Farm Bill. I'm not sure where that discussion is at the moment, but your question makes me realize that the IRA, the Inflation Reduction Act, I just call it the Climate Bill. the Inflation Reduction Act, which includes a huge amount of money for climate action. It's interesting. It structures the tax credits for clean energy and sustainable infrastructure such that your level of tax credit is multiplied something like 5x if you meet certain requirements, including labor requirements. And there's an adder. You get an even bigger benefit if you have apprenticeships. You know, if you're using labor that involves labor unions and apprenticeships. So they've built in a financial incentive to build out the workforce and do it in a financially viable way for companies. And I don't know that anyone's thinking about that for the Farm Bill. So that's an interesting conversation to instigate. The other thing that's interesting is that the IRA allocates $27 billion to the EPA to create a national green bank. Mm-hmm. And they're thinking through right now what to do with that. And I don't know that they're talking about what to do to help transform our agricultural landscape to withstand the ravages of climate change. And so, you know, with the young woman in the film, and I know a lot of folks just like her, maybe the Green Bank should develop financing for farmers that's a rent-to-own financing offering where you work the land for a long enough time and you make payments and you show that you're dedicated and you're invested. Maybe that's something that could be done with some of this new money to sort of start to chip away at this really counterproductive dynamic that exists.
Yeah. A couple back there.
They just needed to warm up.
Hi, I just had a question, from a business student perspective. When you were talking about biodiversity, like loss impact, so how does that like affect businesses? And what are some of like the key benefits that we as like interns or associates can like recommend to our bosses or stakeholders on like how to incorporate biodiversity preservation into a business's like overall strategy for like long-term profit growth and stuff?
Interesting question. Mm-hmm. Should I take that one?
Sure.
Gosh, there's probably a lot of different ways. I think the first thing is awareness raising. I don't think biodiversity loss is like front of mind for most business folks. But when you start to dig into it and you realize that many of the major medicines that we use, aspirin, you know, all of these things that affect our daily lives are actually derived from nature. And as we lose, you know, thousands and, you know, eventually potentially millions of species, we're losing our toolkit to help us solve the problems that we have that we face in our daily lives. So there's very hard-nosed reasons for trying to preserve all this richness that we depend on. And then there's, you know, more spiritual, esoteric reasons, you know, richness in life. You know, I would argue that our lives are enriched by the spectacular array of species that we share the planet with. But so I think there's a lot of different ways that you can do that. But you'll probably find new ones as you get started.
Something to add on that. I assume many of you are familiar with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. If you're not, I would recommend that you go to their website. Go just Google United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. And they do a great job of telling the story of interconnectedness, of how, you know, if you're sitting in a corporate board meeting and someone's just not seeing, why should we invest in this? I don't see the connection. The UN does a great job of showing you how improving water quality in one part of the world can actually improve food security in another part, or how education for girls in one part of the world can improve, you know, some other goal that you might not have thought was connected. So, you know, if you really want to make that case to your employers, put it into business terms. I'd recommend you go be familiarize yourself with the SDGs. There's 17 of them, and what's so interesting about them is when you can click on each individual one, but they're programmed in a way to not be in silos, so that you click on one and it'll show you by improving, let's say it's SDG number 3, you're also going to have so much impact on SDG number 11 and 14. And it really helps you tell that story across different sectors for anyone who maybe is just thinking linearly like a spreadsheet. You know, I like to think visually and maybe in more dimensions as a storyteller. And that's been a really great resource for me to think about interconnections.
Yeah. And then, I would just to give you one concrete example from New York to take the high level from these sustainability goals and marry it with something. I think you're going to want really concrete examples. In New York, we're putting up all these solar farms, and then in some of them, we're planting pollinator habitat, like a rich diversity of flowering plants, and then grazing sheep through, so you don't have to use a mower to keep the vegetation under control. So that's something that the pollinators are helping farmers. You're actually farming around the solar, and then you're helping address the climate crisis with the solar power. So there's some really concrete local examples that you can bring to the conversation.
Can I add just one small piece on that? Just to your point, what could you do to encourage? I think employers are listening. There's so much data out there showing that this next generation of employees and staff care about these issues and do not want to work for a company that's basically just operating as business as usual. So I would just encourage you to keep your voice up. I mean, people are really listening. There's so much data pointing to that. And that's your generation. That's what you're going to bring to this, to say, this is our future, and we will not work for a company that just basically says, well, there's no policy in place, so my job is just to deliver shareholder value instead of stakeholder value. And so I would just encourage you to keep that energy up and keep that heat on.
Yeah, don't accept the answer. It's because that's the way we do it around here. You need to challenge that.
Hi. So my question is, as the bill discussion is coming up, do any of the advocates have possibly any draft with some of the ideas that you guys have presented on this panel and present those ideas to any of the officials already in Congress?
Are we going to present any of these ideas?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that? Can you say, have these ideas been presented to Congress yet, or are we planning to?
So like maybe a draft presenting them with these new ideas just to make the bill better.
Yeah. So to what degree have our legislators really been understanding this? I mean, what is their level of understanding, mm-hmm, as far as your experience goes to date? I mean, would you say that's what you're asking? Okay.
And maybe some of the requests that different advocacy groups are already asking for. I mean, on an international level, I can speak that they have, a lot of the major international nonprofits have come together. I think it's Save the Children that's bringing together a network, and they're advocating to please, like, while reauthorizing the bills, the important, you know, food security, food aid bills, please consider a pilot, for example, that was actually included in the last farm bill, but was never appropriated. I mean, it was never funded, but it was a pilot to stop the practice of what's called food aid monetization, which is another kind of wrinkle in the way we deliver our aid, whereby we don't just drop the food off. We actually give the food, the raw commodity foods, to large international, mostly American NGOs, who then sell it on the local market to fund their development programs in that country. So it's a very complex way of delivering important development programs, which are training farmers, you know, building some of the rural roads and infrastructure to develop a thriving agricultural system, but doing it in a way that's still disrupting the market. So one major ask is to please just, could you just give us the money to run the programs instead of doing it through this, you know, kind of complicated or complex food aid monetization? So that's one big ask.
I would say that we are sharing our ideas and getting some of our ideas from other collaborators who I'm jealous of, because they get to do this advocacy all the time and I'm spread out thin on lots of other issues. But so we are sharing them as much as we can. And I'm arm twisting Roger to come to Upstate and do an event our New York State Senator Kirsten Gillibrand is on the Agriculture Committee, so maybe we can do an event with her at some point on this topic. So yes, we are trying very hard to get these ideas into the mix.
No arm twisting is necessary for that.
There's wine.
Yes, exactly. Right over there.
So my question is that these days there has been a lot of importance towards organic farming, but the produce is very little. And that when it's juxtaposed to the rampantly rising population, how do we plan on producing food that is environmentally sustainable while trying to feed the global hunger?
Want me to take this one or you?
Yeah, why don't you start? I mean, I have thoughts on it.
Go. Farmer. You go. Oh, this is another long, long conversation. So having just come from talking with my neighbors who are large-scale organic farmers, I think part of what we have to do is shift the understanding that organic farming can be done at large scale successfully. I can show you my friend Klaus Martens and his family. His wife, Mary Howell, and son are all, they're farming 2,000 acres right near me in the Finger Lakes, fully certified organic, through complex rotations, highly diversified. So when I asked him yesterday, how are you guys doing? Because we've had crazy weather this winter. It has been hot, Arctic, warm, hot, cold. It's been bizarre. We're worried about our grapes. You know, it's really bad for fruit to have these extreme temperature fluctuations. And he said, I'm not worried because we're so diversified. So he has so many different crops. He has different livestock. He has so many different products that he's, you know, he'll have enough things that do well. So there is a model that I need to get the word out about that can produce. And they do much better in the years with extreme weather than conventional neighbors. So we actually have the highest percentage of certified organic farmland in the state in our little county, because they've been doing it successfully and teaching all the neighbors. But to your point, we need to shift the subsidy structures so they don't incentivize large scale commodity crops, and instead they subsidize healthy farms where farmers can decide, actually, I need to plant some buckwheat in my rotation, and then I need to plant this and this, and so that I reduce, even if it's not fully certified organic, just to reduce those external inputs, reduce the health risks to consumers. I think there's a ton we can do to transition even before we go to full certified organic.
Yeah, I would just add, you're starting to see major shifts also internationally, at least in what programs are being funded to really encourage, not necessarily 100% organic, but much more diversified farming, you know, bringing back the use of pollinator beds. I mean, really in a way that farming in a more thoughtful way, as opposed to this intensive, you know, clearing of the land, plant every single inch that you can on your land, which, you know, you might get a few kind of bumper crop years, but ultimately the land degradation from that kind of intensive farming catches up with you, which I think we now know and hopefully accept and understand and know that that's not the right way to do it. But I also understand that the U.S. domestic agricultural production is growing faster than domestic demand for it. So you have a supply, I mean, we might be overproducing in the United States. And that's why we need these export markets, and that's why we're doing a lot of export promotion. So maybe we just need to kind of reevaluate the whole system and decide, you know, is it not so much about changing everything we're doing, but making some shifts, some conscious shifts to get food to where it's needed or to help it grow in a more healthy and sustainable way locally.
Okay, first I want to thank Gabelli for having you guys here so we can meet and get to talk with you guys. And secondly, as an MS finance student, I'm super sensitive to numbers, so I can't help but notice that the cost that are caused by extreme weathers has increased 700% during the past 40 years. So do you think government should offer financial aid to those who suffer from extreme weathers, and how should farmers should react to the extreme weather?
Your question was, what was the last part of the question?
How farmers should react to what?
Yeah, how should farmers react to the extreme weathers?
The extreme weather events. Oh, yeah. Who did you ask about getting the subsidies? Or the
I'm sorry, what?
You asked about someone. Do we think someone should get a subsidy? Or sorry, maybe I didn't. Never mind. I didn't hear you right.
Sorry.
So the.
Yes.
Yeah.
So should the farmers get subsidies in response to weather, extreme weather?
We almost forgot to talk about subsidy part of the farm bill. So yeah, so there are crop subsidies built into the farm bill that, and one of the things that folks are working on is trying to transform the way that those, that the subsidies are structured so that, for example, if you are using cover crops and not leaving your soil bare so that you reduce flood risk, your insurance premium costs go down. And so restructuring how insurance is done so that you're actually, farmers are actually given built-in incentives to make their farms more resilient and reduce the risk from these events is one part of it. You asked a question that affects the economy wide. So insurance companies are actually some of the first huge corporate actors who were starting to really take the climate threat seriously, decades ago, because they were seeing their costs go up and up and up from the, and they're looking at the weather, extreme weather. And so they've been the most clear-eyed and this whole issue of who pays and the whole social justice aspect of how often it's the poorest people who are most affected by the extreme weather, whether it's Hurricane Sandy or it's indigenous communities who live along the ocean and sea level rise is consuming their communities. There's a huge, huge, huge discussion about who's responsible, who pays, how you compensate people, and farmers are we're just one part of that. But we often get left out in these conversations about frontline communities. I would argue that farmers are frontline communities because we're out there sustaining damage from these extreme weather events regularly.
Yeah, no, I think.
Need a 4-day workshop to work through all these issues.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Meg and I'm a full-time MBA. I actually had a question around large corporations and regenerative farming beyond the benefits of like the reporting disclosures that we're seeing. Like, what do you recommend that the large corporations should be doing, like corporations like Starbucks or Unilever, to really support the farmers with like regenerative crops and like how, because like for like Unilever, for example, they have the Unilever Sustainability Living Plan, which is like a big part of their whole campaign right now for the next like 20-25 years. That's what they're pitching in. So like, what do you recommend, or what do you think that large conglomerates should be doing in terms of dealing with climate change and then really supporting their farmers and their producers?
I'd be happy to take a crack. That's funny you mentioned Unilever. I had the opportunity to work very closely with them, and I think they're very committed through their sustainable living plan, and they really are investing in it. The challenge, I think, for a lot of the consumer goods brands are they don't buy direct. They very rarely buy direct, right? So you have a huge system of traders in there. It's Cargill, it's Archer Daniels, it's Louis Dreyfus, others. So you have to get all those supply chain actors on board. But I think most importantly is you have to commit to buy. Right? Because farmers are small business people, large business people. At the end of the day, they're business people. And what I've seen some things happen, and I've actually stood in the field with cassava farmers in Nigeria that went through a really long training process and became certified in a certain company's sustainable production practices. And then when they turned around and said, okay, and can we just sign some contracts here? We'll do some forward contracts. They said, oh, we can't buy. because there's no processing facility in this country for cassava. Cassava is a very volatile crop once you pull it out of the ground. It's a very useful crop. It's in sorbitol. Sorbitol is a toothpaste. It can be used as a sugar starch. It's a wonderful crop. But for some reason, there's not a good processing capacity for it. But my point is these farmers were pretty disappointed because they spent time getting trained, right? So time away from their fields, and there was no guaranteed market for it. So the number one thing that those companies can do is either push it through their trainers or whatever they need to do, but guarantee a market for the more sustainably produced crop or commodity, whatever it may be.
Yeah. I think the big corporates should all be doing a lot more. That's the quick answer. I think what I've observed is the larger a company gets, the more risk averse they become. And so the less innovative and the less willing they are to stick their necks out. And it's really unfortunate because then the bigger they get, the more resources they have and the more ability they have to shift markets in the right direction. So it's a really unfortunate dynamic that we need to find ways to address. I think companies like Unilever, companies like Interface, we have Interface flooring in our tasting room at the winery. They've really redesigned their product and their whole business around sustainability. And it is as opposed to just saying, let me hire an ESG director who's gonna go out and buy some offsets, right?
Yeah.
We are at a point on the planet where we have to redesign how we live on this planet, how we do business, how we power things, and how we grow our food. This isn't just something that can be addressed with sort of the high level ESG efforts. And I think what we're seeing, the flip side of that is what we're seeing is the companies that really actually do take this on as a transformational opportunity are the ones that are winning. Mm-hmm. When I started out in my career, when I was your age, let's say 20-ish years ago, you know, we would get patted on the head when we talked about renewable energy and solar and sort of like, you know, like, oh, isn't that cute? That's never going to be a real industry. Why don't you kids just go along? Mm-hmm. You know? And now solar is the industry where everyone, you know, if you want to go into energy, you want to be in renewables, you want to be in all of these industries that were poo-pooed. So I think we're, you know, fast forward to today, now we have the opportunity where it's sort of a handful of companies, I'm struggling to think of others here, who are really, you know.
Mars, Nestle.
Yeah, there's making real shifts.
Mars.
Yeah, and they are sort of real outliers, and some of the leaders in that tried to shift their companies have really struggled and maybe not succeeded, but we need to get to a critical mass there where we make it safe to really take this on.
Great. I think we have time for one more question. This right there.
Thank you for the documentary and all the discussion. So I have another question about the food waste. In your opinion, what do you think is the key drivers to the food waste and how it could be addressed? And also in this process, what role could technology be playing in this process? Thank you.
So how do we deal with the food waste issue? So it depends on the context, but I do think shifting the subsidies so that food is you know, farmers get paid more for growing healthier food in healthier ways will help reduce food waste, because it'll be, people will value it more if they pay more. And then the biggest portion of the farm bill is actually support for low-income Americans to be able to afford food. So you could restructure that as well to support people, you know, even with higher food, that they're better able to buy healthier food through that part of the farm bill. So I do actually think properly valuing food is a big part of this. And then I think it's education, it's culture shift. I think it's absolutely totally normal in America for food to be wasted every day, everywhere. And that has to shift. So there's a huge culture element. And on the technology side, I feel like a commercial now. Companies like Generate Upcycle are out there working on building the infrastructure, to process the food waste and recycle it so that we can recapture the nutrients. But you're probably also thinking of technologies like shelf life extension, and I'm sure someone else can speak better to that than I can.
Well, I can't speak to shelf life extension. I can say that I know that the majority of food waste still happens before food is consumed. So it's in the supply chain, not post-consumer waste, which is interesting because we're certainly creating a lot of post-consumer waste also. And I think there, I fully agree with you. I think we need to do true cost accounting of agriculture, which would see our food cost a lot more, but then through smart subsidies for lower income households to be able to purchase that. Internationally, unfortunately, there's still a lot of challenges around getting crops to market. And I'm thinking of this really wonderful innovator from Nigeria who started a small business called Cold Hubs, because refrigeration is an issue there. So smallholder farmers that are producing produce primarily, they're forced to sell the day they harvest because they don't have refrigeration. And so he developed a really innovative system of basically it's like small timeshares and food lockers in major agricultural hubs. So you don't have to buy the entire refrigerator. You just pay rent in a cold locker and you can keep your tomatoes in there until the market gets better. But he's got a wonderful presentation. He's a really renowned social entrepreneur. And in that, he tells a story of a tomato and its journey from the farm to the market. And it's just such a wonderful way that he describes, you know, how the road, an unpaved road, can result in a bruising of a fruit that then makes it, unappealing or difficult to sell at the market. So I also think there has to be really targeted infrastructure investments to improve to decrease food waste so more food actually gets to consumer.
Yeah, I mean, we actually need that in the United States. There's a lack of food processing infrastructure across rural America as well. We saw this during the pandemic with, there's a shortage of butchers. There's bottlenecks throughout the supply chain in the U.S. And then on the end post-consumer food waste side, a lot of food waste that's even collected and goes to a recycling facility can't be recycled because it's full of plastic and all kinds of things. So even, you know, putting something in the farm bill that requires all food packaging material to be biodegradable would be incredible, yeah. Requiring that all single-use food-related utensils be biodegradable, not bioplastic, because that may or may not be biodegradable.
Yeah.
Biodegradable would be huge in terms of making it much more viable to recycle food waste as well.
Great. Well, that's it for us today. I want to thank Liz Osler, Ali Callahan, and Dean Lirzon Aksoy, who made this possible today. The Gabelli School has been great. There are a number of students here. Some of your fellow students were interns actually on this film. So thank you to Fordham for really making this possible today. And on behalf of American Resilience Project, thank you for joining us and help us shape the 2023 Farm Bill.
So in the last few minutes that we have, I want to do a little bit of housekeeping, particularly for those students who are working towards a responsible business leadership certification. So normally you're going to open your app and get a check mark, but I want to remind you with the sustainability, it is a little bit different. I want you to QR code this. You're going to be taken to a form that you have to fill out. You have to this is the only step that you have to self-report. So this will take you to that self-report step. Also remember that you have now completed one of the required of the four steps you need for the certification. So that's great. And for some of you, this might mean that you have met the minimum requirements. Is that true for anyone in this room? Awesome, yay. Congrats. I hope that you will continue. We're also going to email this link to you. So if you're having issues, don't worry, we're going to email it to you. I also, even if you've completed the four steps, I highly, highly, highly recommend you take advantage of the coaching. This QR code will take you to the sign-up sheet for that coaching. That allows you to have a one-on-one leadership coaching session with a leadership coach. Other than that, I'd like to thank you again. Practice these things that you're hearing. Remember that responsible business leadership is built off of two pillars. Self-awareness. They talked today about what we can do to have self-awareness about the food we eat and how we treat our food. And also sustainability literacy. And so they were throwing out terms I'd never heard of, right? So that also was an invitation to me to start Googling some things so that I can educate myself. And I hope this was also informative to you. So thank you all so much. Have a great weekend. And thank you for being here.